Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day of praying and fasting, a day to seek your face, a day to unburden our hearts before your throne so that you can reach out in your, with your gracious hand and help us. We thank you because every time we come, we are never disappointed because we have a Father that listens, that responds to the cry of his children. And as we look at your word, even now, use this word to encourage us about the effectiveness and the usefulness of prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, because we know you've answered.
Thank
in
you,
Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
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 Looking at the message in this, today, the prayer of power. Most likely somebody will say, Pastor, possibly it was a kind of typographical error. I think it should have been the power of prayer. Thank you, my brother. Thank you, my sister. It's not a typographical error. The title of the message is the prayer of power. God will give us the opportunity one day, then we'll talk about the power of prayer. But today, we are talking about the prayer of power. In Zechariah chapter 7, let's see that it is not all prayers that get heaven's attention. But you want your prayer to get heaven's attention. If your prayer is going to get heaven's attention, what must be the foundation of it? Very important. Zechariah chapter 7, I read verse 13. It says, therefore, it is come to pass that as he cried, and they will not hear, so they cried, and I will not hear, said the Lord of hosts. You know, I normally tell people that the way you treat God is the way God will treat you. Here, God says, I cried, they refused to hear. Now it is their turn, they cried, and I will not hear. The way you treat God is the way we treat you. So here are people praying, but God says, I'm not listening. Because when I spoke my word to them and I cried, they refused to listen. Now it is their turn to cry unto me, and I will not listen. Read it again, verse 13. Therefore it is come to pass that as he, that is God, cried, and they will not hear, so they cried, and I will not hear, said the Lord of hosts. So it is to tell you that it is not all prayers that gets heaven's attention. Some people will pray, and God will ignore the prayer. He will not even listen. He will not open his ears to hear that prayer because of their past response. The prayer of the wicked, God will not hear it. God says it's an abomination before him. In Proverbs chapter 28, Proverbs chapter 28, verse 9. So don't just assume that every prayer is heard. No, it's not every prayer that God hears. The prayer must satisfy the necessary conditions for God to hear it. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 9. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be abomination. God says, that prayer should not come before me. I will not hear. But I have good news for you today.
Amen.
God is eager. He's not only just ready, he is eager to hear the prayer of those who are righteous. He's eager to attend to your needs. He wants to hear your request, and he wants to send a solution to those challenges. In Proverbs chapter 15, verse 8, look at what the Bible says. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 8. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. God wants to hear your prayer. It's sweet music in his ears. He says, pray, I'm listening. Call upon me in the day of trouble, I will answer. Call unto me and I will show you great and mighty things. God is ready. The prayer of the upright is God's delight. The faithful, fervent prayer of a righteous man, it will work wonders. It will do great things. The prayer of the righteous is a prayer of power, because it is a prayer that moves the ants that move the world. Think about that. That's why the prayer of the righteous man is a prayer of power. It moves God's ants, who moves the world. And it will move anything that needs to be moved on your behalf. It will shake anything that needs to be shaken on your behalf. It will pull down any stronghold that needs to be pulled down on your behalf. That's prayer of power. And I want to tell you today that if you will pray the prayer of power, you will experience the power of prayer. If you will pray the prayer of power, you will experience the power of prayer. What are the characteristics of the prayer of power? We should be asking ourselves. Number one, the prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. Number two, the prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. Number three, the prayer of power is an overcoming, it's an overcoming prayer. Let's look at the first one. The prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. The prayer of power is a prayer that is prayed in faith and optimism, with the expectation of a brighter hope for tomorrow. Jeremiah chapter 33. When you come to pray the prayer of prayer, you are so, you are looking on the bright side. You are saying, I'm going somewhere. I'm moving towards my destiny. Amen. I'm praying these things for a brighter future. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. God says, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. God says, when you come to pray the prayer of power, you are preparing yourself for a new dimension. You are preparing yourself for a new anointing. You are preparing yourself for a new experience. You are preparing yourself to receive great and mighty things that you have never known before. So when we come to pray, we come to pray with expectation. We come to pray with optimism. We come to pray in faith, knowing that we are going away from that place of prayer better, brighter, bigger, enlarged, equipped, empowered, enabled. So we come with faith. We come with enthusiasm. You know that as I'm coming, when I return from that place of prayer, I'm a different individual. I receive from God. God says, call upon unto me, I will answer thee. Certain. And show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Isaiah chapter 65, verse 24. That's why we can pray with optimism. That's why we can come with confidence, the confidence of faith, to approach the throne of heaven. Because we know our prayers will not be denied. Our request, God will take care. He will answer and send the solution. Isaiah chapter 65, verse 24. The Bible says, and it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. You know, this passage, God says, while they are yet speaking, I will hear. Some years ago, I was at the combined service in Veneto, in Vicenza, at that hotel. And when I came in to the church that particular morning, there was a brother. The brother, he looked very depressed. And I called him and I said, brother, what exactly is wrong? You look worried. You look depressed. And the brother said, pastor, truly, I look depressed. This is my situation. Then he began to speak to me. And then he said, Pastor, the rich, I used to drink, I used to do all sorts of things, but the gospel came to me, I got saved. He said, I was living with a woman. She's not my wife. We have two kids. Eventually, the woman packed out. That one doesn't even bother me. Said, the woman has left Italy. Said, but Pastor, do you know, for the past 3 months, I've not been able to speak to my children. I'm not bothered about the woman, but at least let me speak to my children. I'm depressed. This is my story. So I told the brother, you know, and it was a day. The message was on prayer. I said, today we are praying. You will see what God will do. Amen. And eventually, the message went on. We finished the message at the combined service, and then we started to pray. Brethren began to pray. Say, what is your need? What is your body? Take it unto the Lord. God is going to do something great for you. This brother, he forgot to switch off his phone before the church. So during prayer, the phone started ringing. He will kill it. The phone rang again. He will kill it. The phone rang again. Then eventually, he put it into silence. And we continue praying. We continue praying. When we finished the prayer, as we finished the church, the brother went outside. He opened his phone. And he saw that during the time we were praying, somebody has phoned him about 7 times. He looked at the phone number. I don't know this phone number. I don't know this person. So the brother phoned the person and said, you have phoned me about 7 times. Who are you? And the woman at the other end of the phone said, this is my name. I'm here in Italy. You don't know me, but I'm a friend to mention that woman. And he said, she said, I should give you a new phone number. The brother almost collapsed. He almost collapsed. Later I said, Pastor, is this how God answers prayer? While you are yet speaking, I will hear. Maybe some brethren will know this brother in Veneto. This was what happened. The brother was so joyful. And today is a day of prayer. Amen. I'm telling you, the prayers we have prayed, they are sealed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
It is God that called us to pray. His prayer is not our initiative. It is God's initiative. He's the one that said, it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And somebody says, I don't understand that. Let me tell you how that happens. That before you call, I will answer. Because God knows your need before you call. You know, George Muller, he ran a particular orphanage for homeless children. But at times they will not have food. But you know, God solves the problem even before they pray. One morning, they got to the dining hall. There was no bread, there was no food. So George Muller told all the students, all the children, to sit down at their appropriate places. Say, we're going to bless the breakfast, and we're going to pray, and we're going to thank God for the breakfast. One boy that doesn't believe that there's no food on the table, where is that food going to come from? So he decided not to close his eyes. He opened his eyes while others closed. And then they began to pray and said, God, we thank you for this morning's breakfast. We just want to give you glory for the provision you have made. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the boy that opened his eyes is looking how some crafty people are coming to put food on the table that he will see. He saw that there was nothing. As they said, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The local baker walked in and said, "Yesterday, we were trying to bake bread, but we made a mistake. We baked more than we needed. So I brought the excess for you." That's how that those children ate. They are praying this morning, but God already answered the problem yesterday. God now knew that by tomorrow when they are going to pray, they need bread. But there is no bread for these people. Already a mistake has been made the day before. Do you understand now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Read that passage again. "And it shall come to pass, before they call, I will answer."
Amen.
Before those people prayed for the bread, God already made the provision. By the time they finish, the answer worked in. Those children ate, and that was, and many, many miracles like that happened in the ministry of George Muller. Before they call, God has already made a provision. They need a particular money on a particular day, and somebody has already put exactly that amount of money in the post. You know, it was in the, and they posted it and said, "God ministered to me that you will need this amount of money in your orphanage. So I'm sending it," and they send the money. The day they pray, that's the day that the letter arrives. They open it, it's exactly how much they needed. That's God answering before you call. And my brother, I wanted to know that God knows, your Heavenly Father knows your need, even before you call. And He can already make the provision. So by the time you are calling and you are praying, He's just saying, "I know you will call. I've been waiting for it. Here is it. I already made the provision for you." That's what God is doing. That's what your prayer does. Prayer is the point where we receive heaven's provision. But sometimes that provision has been made already, even before you pray. "I will answer before they call." And if not that, He said, "Otherwise, while they are yet praying, I will be answering. I will be hearing." And that brother, the case of that brother is a case in point. While we were praying, that was when those phone calls incessantly came. Why that day? It's not just a coincidence. It's an answer to prayer. And I'm praying that you will experience this kind of divine provision also in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In James chapter 5. So the prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. When you come to God, come to Him with faith. Come to Him with optimism. Come to Him with expectation. Know that you will not go empty-handed. That if you come to God, you are going to go home rewarded in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In James chapter 5, verse 15. And the prayer of faith, that's the prayer, optimistic prayer. The prayer that God will not deny me. The prayer that God will answer me. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the Lord shall raise him up. And if he had committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. If you will come in faith, you will receive. James chapter 1, in verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask God, that giveth to all men liberally, generously, and doesn't rebuke them, upbraideth not, and it shall be given. For sure, you ask for wisdom, you ask in faith, it will be given. But he says, verse 6, but let him ask in faith. That's the condition. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. Why? For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. If you are double-minded, if your mind is wavering, if you are unbelieving, that prayer will not amount to anything. Come in faith. Know that God answers prayer. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. But if you come in faith, God will answer you. So what we're talking about, the prayer of power, is an optimistic prayer. It is a prayer of faith that heals the sick. It is the prayer of faith that secures the needed wisdom. It is the prayer of faith that comes with the expectation of receiving the needed deliverance. God says, call upon me in the day of trouble. Psalm 50, verse 15. In the day of trouble, you come to God and you know that God can answer. Let me give you one testimony from this week. A sister called me from Nigeria. I said, Pastor, there is a problem. She traveled home. And I said, what problem? Said the land that we bought, they are making a lot of problems over that land. We have not built it over some time. Our neighbors have taken part of the land. I got there now, they are making trouble with me. Pastor, what should I do? I counseled her what to do. No, take a surveyor, this and that, and oh, okay. But afterwards, I said, before you go, let me pray with you. And then we prayed. And I said, God, take control of the situation. All the hearts of those people that are making trouble, oh God, we commit those hearts into your hand. Transform the heart. Take control of the situation. By the time my sister goes to that place tomorrow, there is a solution. Just short prayer. The following day, she went, and I'm talking about this week, she went to the place. Do you know all the people that were threatening her? All the people that phoned her that if you come here tomorrow, you will see Pepe. Everybody piped down. They were now saying, hey, our sister, let's sort out the problem. There is no problem. You are part of the community. We love you so much. Problem was solved. I'm telling you.
Man.
The problem was solved. It's over. Even the ring leader, he was the one that now said, no, we love you, we want to sort out the problem. They sorted everything. My brother, prayer works.
Amen.
Prayer works. There was a particular brother, that's about 2-3 years ago. He also came and said, Pastor, I have a problem. Say, what problem? From Igbo land. He bought the land, and then he went to Nigeria and wanted to start developing the land. And then the, you know, owners of the land said, no, you have to pay another 2 million naira. And the brother said, 2 million naira, what? I bought this land from you, I paid. Even I settled you at that time. How am I, don't have any 2 million naira. You cannot do any work on this land. Eventually the brother reached an agreement and told them, all right, I'll give you 500,000 naira, half a million. Saying, what half a million? We want 2 million. The brother took the case. He took it to the council of, you know, the Eze. These people, they invited them. They abused the Eze. They abused the chiefs. They did everything. Even the Eze said, well, maybe they take the case to the police. The police said, these are rascals. What are we going to do with them? There was no solution. He came back to Italy. Then he phoned me and said, Pastor, look at this. I pay my tithe. I bought land. They will not allow me to develop it. I said, my brother, don't worry. It's your land. Say, yes, let us pray. I will pray. I said, oh God, that land belongs to our brother. Nobody's going to take that land. I take authority over all the people that are making trouble over that land. God, show yourself strong on the behalf of this brother or to those people. In Jesus' name we pray. It's not more than that. About 6 months later, those people called our brother and said, come and take your land. We don't even want any money anymore. Take your land. That's how that brother took his land. He built it. He didn't pay a single penny. When God began to deal with them, they removed their hand. Even the 500,000 naira that he has promised them, they lost that one. They should have even taken that one. They would have had some money. 2 million they didn't get. 500 they didn't get. And our brother took his land and started building without paying anybody. My brother, do you have a case? You can pray. The prayer of power is a prayer that brings results. It's an optimistic prayer. When you pray, pray in faith. Not that you are praying and say, if God answers, I thank him. If he doesn't answer, that kind of prayer has no answer. Because already there is doubt in your mind. The prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. It's a prayer that comes in faith, knowing that when I decree, it is going to be like that. When I tell God to arise on my behalf and do this, God will arise and do that. It's an optimistic prayer. Psalm 50, verse 15. And call upon me in the day of trouble, I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. There is no if in that verse. God says, if you will come, call upon me in the day of trouble. God has already told you what he will do. So if you now have trouble and you don't call God, you can't blame God. God says, if you do your part is to call unto God in the day of trouble. God's part is to deliver you. And then when he has delivered you, you need to give testimony and glorify him. God says, do your part, let me do my part, and then you do your part again. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will arise and deliver you. Then you will arise and glorify me. Let's follow that pattern. And I pray that that is going to happen in your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Psalm 91, verse 15. Psalm 91, verse 15. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him. Honor him.
Amen.
I want you to put your name in that verse and read it with your name. My sister, put your name in that verse and read it. Read it to yourself. I'm waiting for you. Put your name in that verse and read it.
You will be with me in trouble, and you will deliver me and honor me.
Amen.
Can you see what God says he will do? He says he will call upon him. Number one, say, I will answer you. Number two, I will be your partner. You are not going to be in that trouble alone. I will be with you in trouble. Number three, I make sure I deliver you out of that trouble. Number four, I will honor you. What wonderful promises. How can we have promises like this and then we are complaining? How can we have promises like this and then things are going, problems are going unsolved in our life? It shouldn't. We come with optimism. When we come for prayer meeting, we need to come with faith and optimism, knowing that if we're going to pray 100 prayers, all the 100 prayers are going to get 100 results.
Amen.
Come with optimism. We come with faith. Because God has said, if you will call, I will answer. Then we should call, and he will answer. And God never lies. He does what he says he will do. That's why he's God. And if he says he will answer, he will answer. So you call and see him answering. And he will answer on your behalf in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So the prayer of power is a prayer of faith that comes with the expectation of receiving the needed deliverance. It is a prayer that expects the God that answers by fire to answer, and that the fire will fall. Look at 1 Kings chapter 18. Can you see the audacity? Can you see the kind of confidence with which Elijah prayed? Elijah didn't think, if fire didn't fall, they would call me false prophet. And then he would be afraid, and his feet would be shaking. Elijah knows that when I pray, that prayer, it must be answered. That prayer is constant. 1 Kings chapter 18. I read from verse 36. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day, show the people this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. And the things I've done is according to your direction. Verse 37, hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then fire of the Lord fell. He has not even said fire fall down. Fire is already falling by itself. He has not finished his prayer. Fire is already falling. Let me tell you that when you pray the prayer of power, halfway into even the prayer, the problem is already vanishing. The solution is already coming. Fire is already falling.
Amen.
Elijah has not finished praying, but the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, you know one thing? Maybe you didn't understand that verse. You know what God said? When you want to pray, enter into your secret chamber. Many times you want to pray, people will not even see you praying. But you know what God said? Thy Father which seeth you in secret will reward you how?
Openly.
People will see it. The result of prayer is not a result that is in secret. It's not a result that only you are going to know about it. People will see it because God demonstrates his power. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord is the God, the Lord is the God. They renounced idolatry. They jettisoned Baal and said, Baal, you are a false God. We have seen the true God. Because before this time, the prophets of Baal also, they have prayed from morning till evening for fire to fall. No fire fell. And Elijah had mocked them and said, I think he's a God. Does he have ears? Call him, he must hear. He's a God. Maybe he traveled. Tell him to come back because there is an urgent thing to attend to. Or maybe he's sleeping. Wake him up. Tell him that this sleeping is too much. Respond. Baal is dead. He cannot respond. No fire came. But Elijah got there and started to pray. Only a few minutes, the fire fell. That's a prayer of power. A prayer that is prayed in faith, knowing that when I finish praying this prayer, results must come.
Amen.
No shadow of doubt about it. You pray with confidence, the confidence of faith. And the Lord will do it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
It's a prayer that expects the God that answers by fire to answer and the fire to fall. It is a daring prayer that expects God to change his mind, to forgive his people and spare their existence. Look at Exodus chapter 32. How can you pray like that? You are daring. How can you be telling God to change his mind? Prayer of power can do that. And tell God, you have decided you want to do this, but God, I want you to change your mind. I want you to do something else. And God respects that kind of prayer. Exodus chapter 32, from verse 9. And the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen these people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. God wanted to wipe out Israel and start a new nation with Moses and his family. Verse 11, and Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why doth thy wrath wax hot against thy people? Why, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a great hand and with a mighty hand? Wherefore should the Egyptians speak and say, for mischief did he bring them out to slay them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from thy fierce wrath and repent of this evil against thy people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou swearest by thy own self, and said unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto thee, unto your seed, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord repented of the evil. Can God repent? Well, I didn't write this. This is Bible. God changed his mind. He wanted to wipe Israel away. But Moses prayed the prayer of power that caused God to change his mind. Verse 14, and the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. That's how Israel was spared. That's what we're talking about. Optimistic prayer. a daring prayer that expects God to change his mind, that expects God to forgive his people, and expects God to spare the people he wanted to wipe off. That was why Abraham could pray for Sodom and Gomorrah, optimistic that even as bad as Sodom and Gomorrah is, God will spare the righteous. And Abraham prayed with confidence. I said, God, you are a righteous God. If you find 50 people in Sodom and Gomorrah, will you destroy? And God said, if I find 50 people for their sake, I will spare Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham went down to 45 and to 40 and to 35 and to 30 and to 25. You know, but Abraham stopped at 5. And God didn't find 5 righteous people in Sodom. You know how many he found? Only 4. Lot, the wife, and 2 daughters that he rescued. How I wish that Abraham had gone down to 4 and to 2 and to 1. God would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah. That's the God we're talking about. We approach him and we pray. He respects his word. He respects his people. When we come to him and say, God, this is what you said in your word. You are a God that never lies. Rise up and do as you have spoken. God will always rise up and do as he has spoken. But you need to come in faith. The prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. Number 2, the prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. What do I mean? It's a prayer that has a specific beginning, but doesn't have a specific end. The end is varied. You can begin to pray, and maybe 2 days, it may be 4 days, it may be 5 minutes, it may be 1 hour. We know when you pray, when you start to pray, but when you are going to stop, we don't know. It's open-ended. Open-ended. Why is it open-ended? Because it is a prayer with the concept of Operation Push. What does Operation Push mean? P is for pray. U is for until. S is for something. H is for happens. You pray until something happens. You pray until dominion is secured. You pray until victory is yours. You pray until the strongholds come down. You pray until River Jordan parts. You pray until the Red Sea splits before you. You pray until the enemy is brought down. Operation Push. So if you have to pray for 1 hour until the enemy, then your prayer is 1 hour. If it's going to take 2 days, then you pray until that problem is solved. So because of that, the prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. Do you know what? In 1 Kings chapter 18. Let me show you 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. To show you that the prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 1. And it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came to Elijah in the 3rd year, saying, go, show thyself unto Ahab, and I will send rain upon the earth. That's the promise. God says, go and do what is necessary. I want to set rain. Verse 41. And Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. So Ahab went up to eat and to drink. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees and said to his servant, go up now. Look toward the sea. And he went up and looked and said, there is nothing. Elijah didn't mean to pray for 7 times. No. He was to pray until something happens. So the first session of prayer that Elijah prayed, when he finished, he sent his servant, go and see. And then the servant came back and said, there is no sign that any rain is coming. Remember, open-ended prayer, pray until something happens. So Elijah prayed again and sent his servant. Do you know if the second time the sign had come, prayer is ended, Elijah will go home. The servant came back and said, there is nothing. And Elijah prayed the third time and sent the servant, go and see. And the man went and came back and said, there is nothing. And then in verse 43, there is nothing. And he said, go again seven times. He just continued. Every time go, there is no sign. There must be sign. He continued praying. Perseverance in prayer. Importunity in prayer. Verse 44, and it came to pass at the seventh time that he said, behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea, like a man's hand. And he said, go up, say unto him, prepare thy chariot, get thee down, that the rain stopped thee not. And it came to pass in the meanwhile. That was the end of the prayer. Once the answer had come, Elijah said, prayer stops. Do you understand why it's an open-ended prayer? It didn't stop after the first session because the answer had not come. It didn't stop after the second session. The answer had not come. He stopped. It's not just that he wanted to pray for seven times. He stopped when the answer came. And he said, job done. Tell Ahab, rain is on the way. Let him run. Open-ended. My brother, you have prayed once. Nothing has happened. Pray again. You pray, nothing happens. Pray again. It's operation push. Pray until something happens. When a woman is in the maternity ward, the nurses will say, push. And she pushes. Say, the baby has not come. Push again. And the woman is in pain and is pushing. Say, we have not seen. Push. Say, yes, 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 yes. We have seen the head of the baby is coming. But you need to push. Push, push, push. And the woman is going to push until the baby comes out. And I'm telling you, you are going to push until, you know, something happens.
Amen.
Until that victory is secured.
Amen.
Until that problem is solved.
Amen.
Until that challenge is overcome.
Amen.
You will pray until something happens. The prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. We pray until something happens. You remember the case of Jacob. Jacob was fighting with the angel. And the angel said, it's almost morning. Don't let anybody see my shame. Let me go. And Jacob said, if we are going to remain here for the next three weeks, we are going to remain. The only time you will go is when you bless me. I will not let thee go except you bless me. If the angel blesses him after 10 minutes, he will let the angel go. If the angel refuses to bless and say, okay, we are here 2 hours, the angel is going nowhere. After 2 days, the angel is going nowhere. It's open-ended. Jacob said, this struggle, this fighting stops the moment you bless me. I will not let thee go except thou bless me. How long is Jacob going to be in that prayer? When the angel has blessed, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. It's open-ended. You must stay at that altar, the altar of prayer. You must stay at that throne, the throne of grace, until you have the assurance, until something has happened. I tell you one. You know, there was a particular Saturday morning, many years ago in Manchester, God gave me a vision. God took me to our church, where we normally use, say, community center. We didn't have a church at that. We didn't have a building of our own at that time. It was a community center. And God took me in that vision to the community center. And then God took me to the pulpit. The pulpit, there were three seats on the pulpit. And then on the seat on the extreme left, I saw one nasty beast sitting on that seat. On the seat on the extreme right, I saw another nasty beast sitting on that chair. On the middle chair that the pastor ought to sit, it was empty. And the vision left. And I was thinking, what happened? After that vision left, I picked up my phone. I phoned the European overseer. I said, Pastor, this is the vision God has just shown me. Pray with me. So I left. And then I started praying that Saturday. I prayed. When it got to a point, and I had relief in my spirit, I rose up. I knew the job was done. I didn't tell anybody. It was a Saturday. The following morning, we had Sunday worship. When we finished Sunday worship, the following morning, Brother Ayo came to me and said, Pastor, the sermon today was different. Then, a little bit again, Pastor Kenny also came to me and said, Pastor, the sermon today was different. I mean, what happened? Then, after we have sent all the people home, because they were my key workers at that time in the church, I sat them down and I told them what happened on Saturday. And you know, from that moment on, the service in the church was different. I had freedom in the spirit. There were things that were happening in the church. Those demonic personalities, they've been dealt with. It's like you are just a pastor there, but you are not functioning. These were the people controlling the spiritual atmosphere, and nothing was happening. But I prayed that day, and when I had a release, I knew that the job was done. That's what we are talking about. The prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. You pray until something happens. You pray until results come. You pray until you have an answer. You pray until you secure the victory. You pray until that problem, that challenge is taken care of. If it takes 1 hour, we pray 1 hour. If it takes 2 hours, we pray 2 hours. If it's going to take 10 hours, we pray 10 hours. Do you think that Daniel wanted to pray for 21 days? No! Do you realize that the angel told Daniel, from the first day that you prayed, God sent the answer. God does not want to waste your time. What the angel said, but the prince of Persia withstood me. That's why I couldn't bring the answer to you. From day one that Daniel prayed, God sent the answer. But demonic interference, demonic blockage. But did you see that Daniel didn't give up? Daniel continued fasting and praying until there was a breakthrough. 21 days, and that angel came and said, from the first day you prayed, God gave me the answer. But I had blockage. But now I've been able to break through the Prince of Persia. I brought you the answer. It was not that Daniel wanted to pray 21 days, that he started and said, I'm going to fast and pray 21 days. No, it was just that he needed revelation about the situation of Israel. And he made up his mind. This revelation I'm going to get, I'm going to fast and pray. If it takes 1 day, before I get result, let it be 1 day. If it's going to take 5 days, let it be 5 days. If it's going to be 10 days, let it be 10 days. If it's going to be 14 days, let it be 14 days. Open-ended. Thank God by 21 days, the result came. That's what we're talking about. The prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. Elijah went to Mount Carmel to pray. He was not intending to pray 7 times. He did not plan to pray 7 times. He prayed until something happened. He prayed until the sign and the sound of abundance of rain manifested. Daniel did not intend to fast and pray for 21 days. He fasted and prayed until something happened. He fasted and prayed until revelation about the destiny of Israel was given. The prayer of power is a Moses-like prayer that stays before the throne until God changes his mind and spares his people. The prayer of power is an Anna-like prayer that is prayed in Shiloh year after year until Samuel is born. You know, the year that Anna received a miracle was not the first year she prayed. The Bible says she has been following her husband and the entire family to Shiloh year by year. And she's been praying. She prayed year before, no answer. She prayed year before that year, last year, there was no answer. And she continued to pray year by year, year by year, year by year, year by year, open-ended. But the year came and God said, this is your year. And my sister, this is your year. My brother, this is your year.
Amen.
You pray until something happens. Open-ended prayer. That's the prayer of power. It gets results, but it's open-ended. That's why you cannot tell that, okay, I have this challenge, I'm going to pray. I'll pray for 30 minutes. It may not do. You may need more than that. And yet you have another challenge. Say, I'm going to pray for 1 hour. And by the time you pray for 20 minutes, the problem has been solved. It's open-ended. It's open-ended. But one thing is for sure, that prayer will be answered.
Amen.
God responds. The prayer of power is an overcoming prayer. The prayer of power is a prayer that causes us to experience the power of prayer. It is an overcoming prayer that always brings results. Always. John chapter 11, verse 42. See what Jesus said. When you pray the prayer of power, it always brings results. John chapter 11, verse 42. He says, I knew that thou hearest me how many times?
Always.
Always. This is Jesus praying to the Heavenly Father. And he says, I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of these people who stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Jesus Christ said, every time I pray to the Heavenly Father, there is result. Prayer of power gets results every time. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. I read verses 14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have in God. That if we ask anything according to his will, what does he do?
He heareth us.
He heareth us. Anytime we come to God and we ask anything according to his will, he never denies us, he hears us. Anytime we ask him and call upon him in time of trouble, he answers us. When we tell him, oh God, this is the challenge we face, bring a solution, he hears us. When we say, oh God, I want to get married, I need a partner, he hears us. When we say, oh God, I need a baby, oh God, he hears us. He says, this is the confidence. My brother, have that confidence.
Amen.
It's a prayer answering God. Have that confidence. My sister, have that confidence. God is a prayer answering God. And this is the confidence that we have in him. That if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he heareth us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. See, because of that confidence, we know that any time we come to pray, it's sealed, it's sure, it's settled. But we need to come like that. The prayer of power is an overcoming prayer. It's a prayer that always brings results. And I've shown you, Jacob prayed the prayer of power. The angel eventually blessed him. I will not let it go except thou bless me. Did the angel bless him?
Yes, sir.
Moses prayed for Israel. He said, oh God, change your mind. Forgive your people. Don't wipe them out. You know, spare them. Did God do it?
Yes, sir.
Anna prayed, oh God, I need a child. Did God do it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Daniel prayed, oh God, give me a revelation about the destiny of Israel. God did. Elijah prayed, oh God, let these people know that at your word, I've done all these things. Let them know that you have visited them at this time. Oh Lord, send down fire to confirm the word. And God did. All these people, they prayed the prayer of power with outstanding results and outcomes. And this day, we are going to pray the prayer of power with outstanding results.
Amen.
Rise up and let us pray. And we're going to pray the prayer of power. Prayer of power. The prayer that is optimistic. the prayer that is open-ended, the prayer that is an overcoming prayer, the prayer that cannot be denied, the prayer that God always responds to, the prayer that always brings results in your life, in the life of your family, in the life of your son, in the life of your daughter, in the life of your wife, in the life of your husband. This prayer is going to bring results. Rise up and pray and tell God, I come today. Prayer of power, prayer of power, prayer of power, prayer of power, prayer that brings results. Open-ended prayer, optimistic prayer, overcoming prayer. This is the kind of prayer that I'm praying today. I have the confidence that if I ask anything according to your will, you hear me. Today is a day, of power, a day of power. Prayer of power will make you to experience the power of prayer. The prayer of power is an open-ended prayer. The prayer of power is an optimistic prayer. The prayer of power is an overcoming prayer. It's a prayer that always brings results. It's a prayer that is never denied. It's a prayer that you pray until something happens. This afternoon, pray until something happens. Pray until the shackles are removed. Pray until your bondage breaks. Pray until the curse is broken. Pray until River Jordan parts. Pray until Jericho walls come down. Pray until healing manifests. Pray until the miracle is granted. Pray until does something specific, mighty in your life. Pray. The prayer of power. The prayer of power. The prayer of power. The prayer of power. The prayer that makes you to experience. Lord, we thank you because we have the privilege to pray the prayer of power.
Yes, Lord.
We can come in faith and optimism, knowing we will not be denied.
Amen.
We can come knowing that by the time we leave the throne of grace, we are leaving different people.
Amen.
We are leaving with packages.
Amen.
Packages of blessing. Packages of heaven's provision.
Amen.
Packages of miracle.
Amen.
Packages of breakthrough.
Amen.
And we never come to your presence without receiving. Oh,
yes.
We magnify you for this privilege of prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you because this prayer of power is an open-ended vehicle. We pray until something happens. We pray until we have our breakthrough. We pray until the strongholds crumble. We pray until the Red Sea is parted. We pray until the Jordan opens up for us to walk into our victory. We pray until the victory manifests. We pray until the baby comes.
Amen.
Year by year, she kept on going to Shiloh. She kept on praying. She kept on going to Shiloh. She kept on praying until a year, until the baby came. Oh Lord, Operation Push is what we're going to do. We pray until the solution comes. We pray until the answer arrives. We pray until the rain comes down from heaven. We pray until the fire falls down. Oh Lord, we thank you. And we
thank you
because every single person in the Bible that has prayed the prayer of power, they were never disappointed. Moses prayed the prayer of power. You forgave Israel. You spared your people. You changed your mind. Anna prayed the prayer of prayer, power. Samuel came. Daniel prayed the prayer of prayer of power. Revelation about the destiny of Israel came. And Lord, we have seen Jacob prayed the prayer of power. The angel had to bless him. Otherwise, that angel is going nowhere. I will not let it go, except to bless me.
Amen.
And he only let the angel go when the angel blessed him. It was hanging on until the blessing comes. It was praying until the blessing comes. Oh Lord, this afternoon, we have prayed also in like manner. Ours is the victory.
Amen.
I decree that every prayer that your people have prayed, oh God, rise in your goodness and in your graciousness, in your generosity and in your power, in your mercy. Answer from heaven in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As many as have called you in the day of trouble, deliver them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As many as are saying, God, I'm walking through the impossible, walk with them through the valley of the shadow of death and bring them to the place of plenty, bring them to the place of liberty, bring them to the place of freedom, bring them unto a large land in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As many as are looking up unto you for healing, healing from cancer, healing from ulcer, healing from high blood pressure, healing from rheumatism, healing from any kind of sickness or whatever, healing from migraine, healing from unnecessary and unusual heat in the body. I pray this afternoon, let that healing manifest in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As I'm looking up unto you for deliverance, deliverance from satanic dreams, deliverance from satanic oppression, something working all over the body. I take authority over all those satanic manipulations and machinations. I pray right now, everything that is strange in your experience, contrary to the will of God for you, I banish them out of your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And I proclaim divine liberty. I proclaim divine freedom. I proclaim divine deliverance.
Amen.
I proclaim liberty in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As many of our brethren as are looking for the fruit of the womb, today is a day of prayer of power. Oh God, send that baby in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That asked for two boys and one girl, a triplet. Oh God, confirm that request and answer according to our desire in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Ones that have not asked for anything specifically, oh God, the fruit of the womb is their desire, and children are the heritage of the Lord. Oh God, send that heritage and make all forms of barrenness and every single thing that is on the pathway of biological reproduction, let them be crumbled. Fulfill their desire in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Everybody that is looking for progress, oh God, grant them progress.
Amen.
If you are looking for job, oh God, grant them, you know, gainful employment in Jesus' name.
Amen.
For promotion at their place of work and favor, let that favor surround them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Not because the prayer of power is an overcoming prayer.
Amen.
And I can see my brethren, everybody on the platform, I declare you this afternoon an overcomer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, because we know you've answered.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus' mighty and victorious name, I pray.
Amen.
Let the